Namaste and good evening, everyone. Welcome to the 12th session of Tuesday lecture series presented by Vigyan Prasar for Vigyan Prasar Network of Science Clubs. My name is Nitish Srivastav. I'm a project scientist here at Vigyan Prasar and will be your moderator today. It's my privilege to welcome the distinguished panelist of today's session, Dr. Kripa Ram, Assistant Professor in Institute of Environment and Sustainable Development, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. Dr. Arvind C. Ranade, Senior Scientist and National Coordinator of BIPNET Clubs, and Sri Sachin Narbadia, sir, Scientist from Vigyan Prasar. I also welcome all the club members who have joined us for this session today. Thank you everyone for joining the session. As you all know, that ozone is a greenhouse gas that exists throughout our atmosphere. 4 billion years ago, before life on Earth, the planet's atmosphere contained much lower level of ozone, and at that time, much higher levels of UV, ultraviolet sunlight reached the planet surface than today. It took the development of ozone layer in the atmosphere for life to be able to withstand the damaging effect of intense ultraviolet sunlight radiation. But in the last few years, the ozone layer has depleted extensively. Thus, on September 16, 1987, the United Nations and 45 other countries signed the Montreal Protocol on substances that deplete the ozone layer. Every year, this day is celebrated as the International Day for the Preservation of the Ozone Layer. In order to participate in this global initiative in a much more justified manner, it is necessary to understand what is ozone, why it is important to us. So our today's talk will discuss about it. The title of today's lecture is Ozone and Environment, How It Is Important for Us. The speaker is Dr. Kripa Ram, Assistant Professor from Banaras Hindu University. The talk will be of 30 to 40 minutes, followed by interaction session. If any of the participants wants to ask anything regarding the today's session, you can type it in the comment section of YouTube. The participants can type their question there. Once the session will be over, I will ask the question to the speaker on your behalf. Now, without taking much time, I would like to invite Arvind sir to please introduce our today's speaker.
Dhanyavaad, Dr. Nidhi. सभी विपनेट क्लब के हमारे एक्टिव सदस्यों को मेरा प्रणाम। जैसा आप सब लोग जानते ही हैं कि हम पिछले लगभग 2 महीने से आपके लिए मंगलवार के दिन एक विशेष विषय और एक विशेष विषय के साथ एक विशेष वक्ता आप लोगों के सामने हम लाने की कोशिश करते हैं कि जिसकी वजह से हमें ज्ञान एवं प्रौद्योगिकी के क्षेत्र में जो भी कुछ नया चल रहा है जिसके बारे में अनुसंधान हो रहा है और हमारे जीवन में उसके साथ किस प्रकार से हमारा जीवन उसके साथ जुड़ा हुआ है ऐसे कई सारे विषय को लेकर हमने अभी तक ऐसे बहुत सारे व्याख्यान किए हैं और जैसा डॉक्टर निधि ने कहा बताया है कि आने वाले 16 सितंबर को एक विश्व ओजोन दिवस के नाम से हम लोग जानते हैं और स्वाभाविक है कि हम जब ओजोन की बात करते हैं तो ओजोन किस प्रकार से हमारे लिए महत्वपूर्ण है हमारे जीवन शैली के लिए महत्वपूर्ण है हमारे पर्यावरण के लिए महत्वपूर्ण है और जहां तक COVID-19 के साथ इसकी अगर हम चर्चा करते हैं तो वो हमें पता चलता है कि COVID-19 की वजह से जिस प्रकार से लॉकडाउन लगभग पूरे विश्व में रहा है उससे हमें काफी हद तक ये ओजोन जो डिप्लीशन है उसको कवर करने में मदद मिली है तो एक प्रकार से ओजोन एक ऐसा वायु है ऐसा गैस है कि जिसकी हमें नितांत आवश्यकता होती है तो आज इसी विषय के ऊपर हम लोगों से चर्चा करने के लिए हमने खास आमंत्रित किया है जो उस विषय के विशेषज्ञ हैं सो आई जस्ट फील लाइक वी ऑलवेज बीन ट्राइंग टू bring the good people, those who are working in the field of recent developments in science and technology. And every time we try to bring good people, there's people who have been working in the field of science and technology. And every time we come up with some different topic and different subject, those are associated and related to our daily life. And of course, 16th September has been celebrated as a World Ozone Day. And I think what Dr. Nidhi has correctly mentioned, the importance of ozone is manifold. Like ozone is something that, you know, if it would not have been there, perhaps life would not have been possible on the planet Earth. So the importance of ozone informed to all our youngsters. So in the process, I just would like to mention that Vigyan Prasar, in association with SAMA, which is a South, so of course then the IMD, Indian Meteorology Department, and then Indian Meteorological Society, we all are going to celebrate the World Ozone Day on the 16th of September. And especially that campaign is going to start from 15th of September to 10th of September to 15th of September. And that is something like we are organizing online quiz competition. So I will request all of you to please join on the vvm.org.in, and that quiz is open for the class 8 to 12. And the importance of ozone is known to be, is need to be informed to all the people. And we should also be thankful for the, nature, which has provided us a beautiful layer. And as I said, like every time we bring a, expert from the field, and when we talk about the ozone, then I think Kripanji will be the right person to speak about the importance of during the, pandemic situation, re-establish or recover the ozone depletion in a bigger way. So I think Dr. Kriparam will enlighten us on those aspects. And that's why it is a great privilege for me to introduce the today's speaker, Dr. Kriparam. So introducing him, I can say that Dr. Kriparam is currently working as an assistant professor in the Institute of Environment and Sustainable Development at Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. Earlier, he completed his PhD in the field of chemistry in the year 2010 from Physical Research Laboratory, Ahmedabad. He has been outstanding researcher experience in the area of atmospheric and aerosol chemistry, climate change, measurement of an optical properties of aerosol and radiative forcing, and geochemistry of aerosol soil and aquatic system. Dr. Ram done extensive research in the field of atmospheric and aerosol chemistry during his postdoctoral period in the University of Tokyo, Japan, and later on in 2013, he joined in IIT Bhuneshwar as an Inspire faculty. He has also served as a scientist in the National Environmental Engineering Research, that is NIRI, at Nagpur. In March 2014, he joined its present institute at BHU. He has published more than 45 research papers in the peer-reviewed international and national journals. He has three books in his credit, book chapters in his credit, and also written a book. He has presented his work in the more than 50 national and international conferences. Dr. Ram has received some of the prestigious awards from the various professional bodies like President's International Fellowship Initiative Award for Visiting Scientists, then Chinese Academy of Science China in 2018, Connect Fellowship of Alexander Van Humboldt Foundation, Berlin, Germany, Early Career Research Award from Science and Engineering Research Board, that is SERB, from Government of India, and Summer Internship Program Award for the teacher in 2016 from Physical Research Laboratory, Ahmedabad, and many more. So I think Dr. Kriparam will be the right the expert who will not only enlighten us, but will also explain the importance of ozone in our daily life. So Dr. Kriparamji, first of all, thank you for accepting our invitation, and we look forward to hear your important topic of today's world. And I request you to please come forward and deliver your talk. Thank you, Kriparamji. Thank you, Dr. Didi.
Thank you. So, I'm sharing my slides, just a second. And, is the slides visible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, a very good afternoon to everyone. And at the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Ashok Ranade, Vipin, Dr. Nisha, for inviting me for this lecture, actually. And So to start with, what the discussion topic will be like, ozone and environment, how important it is for us. And thank you very much, Dr. Ranade, for your nice introduction. And it's very important for all of us to take care of our environment, because it is very important we breathe air from there. It is very important for plants and other things that we grow. So before I start, I would like to thank all the teachers, because I have known that we have most of the teachers that are present in these lectures. So belated Happy Teachers Day to all of you. And then I would like to thank this world, urban environment for this taking 16th December as a World Ozone Day. So this is very important day for all of us as an environmentalist, and we must take care of environment. So before I start, it is very important for us that how this environment is important for us. So if you remember that the Earth atmosphere is very unique in the sense that its atmospheric composition, it's present of whatever the different composition of gases are there. The temperature is very adequate that we can make it, that makes it habitable, unlike the other planets. So I will be discussing these things in the coming 45 to 40 minutes. So for example, one of the very important things that I always discuss is like why Earth has a habitable environment and why it is very important. So this is, there are many reasons for that. Then I will be discussing only a few which are very relevant for today's discussion, like location. So as we all know that it is located from one astronomical unit from the sun at a distance of one astronomical unit. And then the temperature is very important, because the global average temperature of Earth is about 15 degrees centigrade. That makes it very suitable for all the habitat to make it presence here. And then the third important thing is that the presence of the atmosphere and its composition. So we have different kinds of gases, major and trace gases in the atmosphere. There are many more like aerosols that are very important, but I'm not going to discuss all those things here. So if I will start with this one. So what controls climate on a planet? Okay. We all know that sun's radiation is very important, and it gives the major source of energy for us. So if we consider the following four inner planets of our solar system, Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars. So if you see their location, Earth is about one astronomical unit. Mars is little away from here, about 1.5 astronomical unit. And then we have a Venus, which is less than one astronomical unit, about 0.7. And Mercury is very close, which is about 0.4 astronomical units. So what is very important here, because we know that the sun is the main source of energy. It gives all the energy to us. And energy, as we move from the sun, the energy varies as a 1 upon r square, 1 upon distance square, basically. So, for example, if you consider Earth, it receives almost like 342 watts per meter square of solar radiations. The question marks here tells that there are slight variations, which is less than 1%, actually. But that is very important for the climate and other things. So I'm not going to discuss that one details, actually. But if you see here, as I said, that the scale varies, energy that which receives the planet is varying by 1 upon distance square. So for in that case, if you consider this, Mercury would be receiving an energy of about 2050 watts per meter square, Venus about 600 watts per meter square, and Mars will be having and receiving an energy of about 150 watts per meter square. I will be connecting these two, so just remember the numbers here, only 342 watts per meter square that sun, that the Earth receives from the sun for Earth atmosphere. So what is this actually important? So as I said that the global average temperature of the Earth atmosphere is about 15 degrees centigrade. But what if you predict this against like equilibrium temperature? I will be discussing this equation. So the temperature would have been around minus 19 degrees centigrade. So if you can see here that there is about 35 degrees centigrade difference between the observed, which is actual temperature, 15 degrees centigrade, and the predicted temperature, which is about minus 19. So there is about 35 degrees centigrade difference in this one. So why it is very, the temperature difference is there. So if you just look at it, that hot controls effective temperature of the planets. Basically, you have a radiative balance equations. I think most of the teachers of must be knowing this one. I'm putting this equation to put in the perspective that why the solar radiation is very important, and then how ozone comes into the picture. So and then these greenhouse gases. So then I will be discussing about the ozone. So if you see this equation, T effective, where here we have T effective is effective temperature, alpha is albedo, which is the radiation that is reflected back by the surfaces to the atmosphere. In case of Earth, it is about 0.3. S0 is solar constant that we already discussed about 342 watts per meter square. But if you take about 4 sigma here, then it will be multiplied by 4. And sigma is, of course, Stefan-Boltzmann constant. So if you see in this equation has only three variables, like alpha, S0, and this sigma. Sigma is, of course, not very varying, actually. So temperature effective will be controlled by alpha and S0. So now here is very important that what is the composition of the atmosphere, which is making more important here. So basically, we have as I discussed, that there are three facts that I will be discussing in this one. So the three main gases are major gases. You have nitrogen, oxygen, and argon, which are abundantly present in the atmosphere. But there are minor or trace gases, which are equally or even more important to control the climate and temperature of the Earth's surface. In this, actually, we have two very important greenhouse gases, carbon dioxide and ozone. I will be not discussing about the aerosols and suspended particulate matter in this one. So this is how the Earth's climate looks like. You have a sun, and in the Earth we have like atmosphere, land, ocean, then ice, and then subsurface we have beneath the Earth's surface. So whatever the radiation that comes from the sun, that about 31% is reflected back to the atmosphere. That is called albedo. And only about 69% is absorbed by the surface. And then these 69% absorbed radiation, as well as the energy that is there within the Earth, that also is released. And then we have a terrestrial radiation from the Earth. And this temperature within the top of the atmosphere or in the atmosphere is very important to discuss about the temperature. So what is the incoming solar radiation and what is the outgoing solar radiation from the Earth's surface? This controls effectively the temperature of the atmosphere. So for example, suppose in the terrestrial environment, you don't have any greenhouse gases, the incoming solar radiation and then outgoing terrestrial radiation, that should be in equilibrium, that should be in balance. But what we are doing, actually, we are extracting and burning lots of fossil fuels, and then we are ejecting lots of CO2 in the atmosphere. So CO2, as we know, that is a major greenhouse gas, and what it will do, it will absorb the radiation within the atmosphere. So once it is absorbed the radiation, it will lead to an increase in the temperature. So it will not allow the radiation to the terrestrial radiation to go back, rather it will trap the radiation within the atmosphere. And once it traps the radiation within the atmosphere, it will increase the temperature. So this is very important, the 35 degree centigrade temperature that we have difference that I talked in the very beginning is because of the greenhouse gases. But now here is a problem. So if you imagine a situation that you keep on increasing the CO2 gas, what will be happening? Now more and more solar radiation will be trapped within the atmosphere. This means we are now trapping more of radiation. That means more of energy in the atmosphere. And when it will re-emit the atmosphere, in the energy in the atmosphere, it will again increase the temperature of the atmosphere. So we cannot increase. So for example, when in the pre-industrial era, about 1850, we had that CO2 concentration about 280 ppm, and now CO2 concentration has increased about 420 ppm or so. So there is almost a very huge increase in the CO2 in the atmosphere. So these greenhouse gases, although it is very important for making our atmosphere habitable, if there is a more amount of greenhouse gases, it will further lead to an increase in the temperature, and which is not very good. So we have to cut down on this. Okay, so this is one of the very important things. So this is what I discussed. If you control this inner temperature, and I just to give you a number here, and all the numbers are given, the albedo, solar radiation, and the net solar radiation that is coming. So you just see last two column, effective equilibrium temperature and actual temperature that we measure. So the mercury should have equilibrium temperature about 162, and actually when it is measured is about 180 degrees centigrade. So it is almost like matching this one. But Venus should have a temperature of -10, but actually measured temperature is about 453 degrees centigrade. That's very high. On the similarly, on the Earth, actually it should be -19, but we have 15 degrees centigrade. So these two differences are basically, and then in the Mars, it nearly agrees with the what is there. So here, the not only the incoming solar radiation, but the presence of the atmosphere and the different components, basically which leads to the different values of albedo, play a very important role. So as I know, I think it is very clear now that the greenhouse gases are very important for us. They trap the outgoing thermal IR radiations and then lead to increase in the temperature and making the atmosphere as a habitable. But what about ozone? So why we actually care about the ozone? This is very important question that we should be addressing. Just to remember that you can just imagine a situation that our Earth's atmosphere, the kind of environment has been built for us, and the proportion of all the gases, they are fixed in such a manner that the temperature is very important. You have enough oxygen for breathing, and you have many other gases which are there actually, which are equally important. I will take you again back to this black body emission curves from the sun and the Earth atmosphere. So if you see that the sun is actually emitting radiation about 500 nanometer, where about the Earth is emitting the radiations, peak radiations about 10 micrometer. So we have a short wave and long wave radiations, okay? If you see very clearly here, solar emission spectrum, assuming the temperature of the solar sun actually about 6000 Kelvin, you can see the peaks here. Here the visible, we have three important reasons: ultraviolet, visible, and infrared radiation. So visible radiation is very important for all of us for habitable atmosphere. But what is important here, as we know that ultraviolet radiations, they have a lower wavelength, and since they have a lower wavelength, they are associated with high energy. So what will happen if this ultraviolet radiation, all the ultraviolet radiation that is emitted from the solar, from the sun, is coming to the Earth atmosphere, the energy will be very high. And that energy, if the energy is very high, what will happen? There will be very kind of different situation for us actually, for plants, for animals, for aquatic systems, everything will be disturbed. So here the ultraviolet radiation, ozone plays very important role here in not allowing reach the Earth surface. So this is one of the very important things. And how did it do that one, we will be discussing in the next few slides. So as we all know that most of the ozone is trapped in the stratosphere about say more than 50 kilometers or so. So atmospheric ozone interacts with the solar as well as terrestrial radiation, but it absorbs ultraviolet radiation and visible solar radiation, and it hits the middle atmosphere where the concentration is the highest, especially in the stratosphere. So stratospheric ozone absorbs the UV rays and the sunlight from the sunlight, and thus is prevent the high energy UV radiations to reach in the Earth surface. So this is the one region it is called as a good ozone. In contrast, in the lower atmosphere, we have the ozone which leads to the formation of smog, and then it also reacts with the different kind of plants. I will be discussing this one in the couple slides. So this is not very good actually. So tropospheric ozone is not very good, and it is called as a bad ozone. Okay, so I hope that you have seen this temperature graph, vertical temperature or vertical distribution of this temperature. So if you see here, there are two zones that are very important. One is thermosphere and other one is in the stratosphere. Stratosphere is about say 14-15 kilometers to about 50 kilometers, whereas thermosphere is about 90 to 120 kilometers or so. So in the thermosphere, what happens, you have oxygen and you have very high UV radiations, especially the radiations that has the wavelength in the order of 120 to 210 nanometers. when they interact with oxygen, so they actually dissociate. There will be a photo dissociation of oxygen. Although oxygen is an inert gas, as we all know, it's not. It doesn't react readily with any kind of species. But when it is photo dissociated, oxygen radicals are formed. So these radicals become very important, and these radicals, they again react with the ozone, the oxygen that is present in the stratosphere, and they lead to the formation of ozone. And not only that, this ozone again, if the radiation is say around 310 nanometer, so if this ozone can also be destroyed, it can also break into different oxygen and then this radical oxygen molecule and the nascent this what you call oxygen radical, and you have a destruction also. So there will be a cycle of ozone, oxygen that is getting converted to ozone, and ozone getting converted back to the oxygen. So this cycle goes on in the stratosphere. Okay. So now we will be discussing again here. So photo dissociation, as I discussed, is very important. Radiation that is about 120 to 210 nanometer, it gives one oxygen molecule, which gives two oxygen nascent oxygen, and it is basically reactive. So that becomes very important. Now, what is the question that comes, that what is the controlling factor which controls the photo dissociation? So of course, the wavelength, we discussed about, it should be about 110 to 200 nanometer. That is very important. And then variation in the oxygen density. So if you see that oxygen concentration also varies actually. If you see that oxygen, as the altitude increases, the oxygen density decreases. Okay, so that this photo dissociation will be also important, and it will dependent on the oxygen density. And then another important parameter is photon flux. Photon flux is actually h nu. So how many photons that are coming from the solar radiation of that particular wavelength? For example, 100 to 200 nanometer. So the important cycle that converts this oxygen into ozone is known as a ozone as a Chapman cycle. It was first introduced by a Sydney Australian scientist in 1930, and then this also proposes that how this reaction can lead to the formation of ozone layer. That will be discussion topic of the discussions, today's discussion. Okay, so the Chapman cycle explains how the ozone layer is formed and how it is maintained actually. So it is described in the following reactions. So the initiation reactions, if you are from the atmosphere, from the chemistry, you simply know that oxygen, when there is a appropriate light, this oxygen molecule will break into two nascent oxygens, and this nascent oxygen will be having a propagation or cycling reaction. One of this nascent oxygen will combine with the oxygen molecule in the presence of some extra agent, and then it will form like, you know, ozone. And then this reaction is exothermic actually. So that's why you see that temperature increase in the stratosphere. But at the same time, if the radiation is say about 220 to 300 or 320 nanometers in UV radiation, then if this ozone can again interact with this light, and then it can be dissociated in the oxygen molecule and a nascent oxygen. And in the termination process, again this ozone molecule and then this oxygen, nascent oxygen, will combine to give two oxygen molecules. So in principle, what is happening here, this ozone, there will be a kind of a cycling process, because we start with the initiation, we start with the oxygen molecule, and then there will be a formation of ozone in between, and then you finally have a oxygen formation again back in the kind of things. So this is what is happening here, the three important processes. It is also explained here, and the time scale is also shown here. So for example, ozone to from oxygen dissociation happens about say 10 to the power minus 4 to 10 second scale, and then is when this it combines with oxygen, it combines at a little bit longer time scale, about 60 seconds to 3 minutes, and then it leads to the formation. And then again it the kind of, you know, like ozone is again dissociated to the nascent oxygen, and so there will be a kind of rapid interconversion of oxygen and ozone between these things. So this is in a schematically, if you like, here it is shown in the above 50 kilometer, what is happening? Very high energy ultraviolet radiation. This strikes and this breaks oxygen molecule into two nascent oxygens or free oxygen atoms. And out of these two, they will combine with one of the oxygen atoms that are oxygen molecule that is present, and they will form in the ozone molecule. So this happens in the ozone production happens in the stratosphere above 50 kilometers. But what happens in the between 50 and 15 kilometers? Because the solar radiation is coming, so incoming radiation will be having the higher wavelength. So this for ozone production, we need a radiation of 100 to 200 nanometer. But ozone destruction, because the radiation is decreasing, energy is decreasing, so the wavelength will be increasing. So you have about 200 to 300 nanometer. So ozone destruction will be there. One ozone molecule will give one oxygen and one oxygen molecule and one oxygen nascent oxygen, and then they can again combine with the free one nascent oxygen can combine again with the ozone molecule there, and this can give to the again the oxygen molecule. So this is again the cycle that we were discussing. Now one of the very important parameter that is measurement of this ozone. Okay, so unlike different gases are measured in the atmosphere, you can measure in the microgram per cubic meter or ppm or ppb. For ozone, we have a very specific unit, and this unit is called Dobson unit. Okay, so if you consider that all the because you know we have an atmosphere, and if you consider that atmosphere in the atmosphere, you can consider kind of in a box, in which box about the area, a box of area 1 centimeter square, and you compress all the ozone that is present in that particular 1 centimeter square area and make a thickness of 3 millimeter thickness, then the number of ozone molecule that will be present in 1 centimeter square, that will be called as a Dobson unit. So basically this is very strange unit, but this is very important because ozone distribution is not very homogeneous, and the lifetime is very important, and the reaction that is keep on happening here. So this kind of, you know, we have another unit which is called Dobson unit. So basically 3 millimeter of thickness of ozone is equivalent to 300 Dobson units. So just remember this one. And about similarly, that means 100 Dobson unit is about 1 millimeter thickness of ozone at standard temperature and pressure. Okay, so this is very important. In the next few slides, we will be keeping these units, Dobson units, for this one. And the importance of this one was discovered by this three famous scientists, Paul Crutzen, Mario Molina, and then Rowland. So, and they actually got Nobel Prize in 1995 for discovery of the ozone layer. So what they proposed, we will be discussing a little bit on that one. So they discovered that chlorofluorocarbons, they are very important species which can stay in the atmosphere of about 10 to 100 years in the atmosphere. And these are susceptible to break down. These are very susceptible to break down and release the chlorine atom when they have a UV radiation. And this, they predicted that the CFCs will reduce ozone inventories. And owing to this one, this proof came in sometimes in 1985 about this ozone hole or decrease in the ozone concentration. And then immediately in the couple of years, we have a Montreal Protocol in 1987 for the prevention of ozone or how to ozone hole can be recovered. So this is, if you see here, so in the slide shows in the x-axis, you have 1956 to 1988. This is old data. And if you see the concentration of ozone on the y-axis in the Dobson units, that until about say 1972 or so, the ozone concentration was more than about 275 Dobson unit. But then after 1972 or 72, after that, there is a very big decrease in the ozone concentration. And if you see here, somewhere around 1985, the concentration of ozone reduces to almost like 150 Dobson units. That was a very huge reduction, almost a factor of 2 decrease in the ozone concentration. And this, again, now we have a satellite, so we can measure this ozone concentration. This is the Antarctic ozone hole that was discovered. And if you see the concentration again here, the data says that from 1960, how to till date, like 2010, how the ozone concentration has varied. So like it, you can see very clear decrease in the ozone concentration. And OMIS, like satellites, like total ozone mapping satellites, spectrometer, TOMS, and ozone monitoring instruments, they actually used to measure the ozone concentration, the columnar ozone concentration. And what you see here, the concentration of the ozone measured by OMI can be as low as about 120 or 110 dofcent. So there is a very clearly, there is a huge decrease in the ozone concentration. Now then, so what is ozone hole actually? So ozone hole is not like you consider something like a hole, but there are different places where the ozone concentration is literally very low.
Sir, your voice is muted.
And about the code is I think so. Okay, so this is the current. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah. It's okay. You can continue.
Okay. So, this is how this actually, you know, in the southern hemisphere, how the in the different total column ozone concentration varies, okay? And you can see just not only this decrease there by year to year, but there is a seasonal decrease also. So usually you have an ozone hole minimum sometimes in August, September, or October, you know, basically in the southern hemisphere. And then this, at the same time, when you have lower ozone concentration, you can see in the left slides, ozone hole area also increases. So what are the key ingredients that make this ozone hole? So there are very few, and I'm not going to discuss all of them. Chlorine is one of the very important species, and this is supplied by man-made CFCs. We will be discussing that, how this chlorofluorocarbons can lead to this one. And the temperature is very important here as well, actually. This most of the ozone hole has been discovered in the colder areas, where this ozone hole and this ozone can react with the chlorine molecule on the colder surfaces, basically on the ice surface. In the seasons, dark and light seasons that we have already discussed, this one, you have polar stratospheric cloud formation, and then UV radiations in the springtime sunlight. Okay. So this slide shows that chlorofluorocarbons, that the two that are very important, that CFC-11 and CFC-12, they are very important for this ozone reduction. So like they are also called sometimes like a miracle compound. They are inert and they are cheap and they are can be used in many applications. And because of their inert and cheap and many applications, because they are very cheaper, they are used in various kind of applications like foam and insulation, propellant, they can be used. They are widely used in the air conditioning. So we used in the air conditions, they are basically widely used. And then in the electronics, many electronics formation, they can be used. there are different kind of CFCs, but as I said, the CFC 11 and CFC 12 are very important. CFC 11 means you have 3 chlorine molecule, and 12 you have a 2 chlorine molecule here. And then there you can see here in the atmospheric lifetime, CFC 11 and 12, they are very, you know, they can stay in the atmosphere about 60 to 120 years. So these are very important. Other gases are also very important for this one. And they have a ozone depleting potential. But what you see that this, if you consider this one, CFC 11 and 12, they have a ozone depleting potential.
Sorry to disturb.
Huh? Yes, please.
Yeah, I think your slide is not changing.
Oh, not changing.
Because right now, okay. That the, only the graph is coming.
So it is not changing now also?
No.
I can see here.
You can stop it and then again share it. I think there is some network connection in between. That's why it happened.
Okay, so I will do that. Okay.
Yeah. You can again share it.
Slide sharing. I should stop, right?
Yeah, first you need to stop it and again start sharing.
Okay, begin.
Yes.
So where should I stop this one? Because I didn't
It has been stopped. Now you can just share screen.
I can just again share, right?
Yeah.
So is that okay now? No. Repeat.
No, sir. No. Screen has not come.
Hello?
Screen has not come.
Screen is not set.
Yeah.
The screen has not come. Okay, so let me just try. How to stop sharing this one then?
It has been stopped. It is already stopped. You just click on share screen on the bottom.
Okay. Then,
yeah, now
it is sharing. Yeah. Can you see this one?
Yes.
Oh,
you can just maximize it.
I'm sorry, it may be some technical.
Yeah, network. Yeah.
So I was here actually, CFC compounds. So ozone depleting potential, you have a different kind of ozone depleting substances. Halons, now recently they have been discovered. Halons are very important and they have a more ozone depleting potential. For example, this halon 12-11 like CF2-Br2-Cl, they have an ozone depleting potential of about 2.2 to 3.5. But they have a slightly lower atmospheric lifetime. But that doesn't mean that they are good actually. They are still very bad. So if you, for example, in all the refrigerators that we use, but now the government has banned this use of CFCs. We are using now different kind of coolants for that one. And then in the electro, other purposes in the phones and other places, we are now not using that kind of CFCs. Okay, so this is another one is like you have a Arctic polar vertex are formed. These are large polar land mass and these ice covered and large temperature gradients. So because of the large temperature gradients, there is a circular airflow around the Antarctic. And then there will be like, you know, I think the slides is again. So, hello?
Yes, sir.
Slides was, I'm not able to move my slides actually. So, this was, okay, now. Yeah. So, this is another example is polar stratospheric cloud actually. These are also occurs during austral winter when you have no light, but the environment is very cold, and these are concentrated, activated by chlorine molecule. This is very important. Chloride is again, and then not only chloride, there is again, because they can react with the ozone, and they can form ClO. So this chlorate also becomes very important, and that can also react with this one. And then you have ice crystal act as a reaction site. So you have all the ingredients there, because you have low temperature, you have ice crystals there, and you have ozone depleting substances like chloride is radicals, and then ClO, and they are very important for the ozone destruction. So this is very important. Okay, so the mechanism that ozone loss by UV photolysis, here the how it happens with the chlorine. So it's basically chlorine is first UV radiation. This chlorine atom dissociates from the CFCs. Vipin.
Yes, sir.
Just a second. Actually, I'm getting a call from my office. So. Ha, Anuj. मैं एक लेक्चर में था, बताओ जल्दी बताओ. मैं कॉल करता हूँ, 10 मिनट में, 15 मिनट कॉल करता हूँ. ओके, सो दिस ऑस्ट्रियल स्प्रिंग बेसिकली सनलाइट अपीयर्स. सो यू हैव अ यूवी रेडिएशन दैट स्प्लिट्स ऑफ क्लोरीन एटम फ्रॉम सीएफसीज. दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. सो इफ यू डोंट हैव दिस सीएफसीज, दिस क्लोरीन एटम, अंटिल दिस क्लोरीन एटम इज टेकन बाय, इज डिसोसिएटेड फ्रॉम दिस सीएफसी मॉलिक्यूल, दिस रिएक्शन विल नॉट स्टार्ट. सो दिस क्लोरीन, वंस दिस क्लोरीन, one chlorine atom is dissociated from the CFC, this will start, this will first react with ozone and this will form like a ClO, another radical, so that is more reactive, and this ClO again react with the nascent oxygen that is there, and this will again lead to formation of chlorine and oxygen. Okay, so again here ozone plus one nascent oxygen will give rise to the two molecule of oxygen. So what is happening here, effectively one ozone molecule is, when one molecule of ozone is lost, you get a two oxygen molecule is produced. So basically here again you are getting a ozone loss. So this is very important. This is the structure of the CFCs, and then how they, I think I can play the video, but media is not found, so we can just move from here. The another effect that I'm going to discuss with you, that is becoming very important for all of us, is like effect of ozone air pollution on plants. So as we all know, if you have a high ozone and these plants are very reactive, these plants leaves can react with the ozone molecule. And then what will happen, if you have, there are two slides that are shown here, you have a clean air, basically that means less ozone you have, and if you add ozone, you can see the color changes in the leaves. So basically the photo, what will do, what it will do if you have high ozone, it will lead to the decrease in the photosynthesis. So if it decrease in the photosynthesis, so all the processes, grain and then production of the grains, that will be again decreased. So this is the, this slide shows that how the ozone can affect the crop production. This now studies are coming very, people are studying, there are many researches that are coming, that how the ozone and what should be the optimum ozone that should be good for the crop productivity. And you can see here different kind of, you know, what you call, crops, sorghum, field corn, winter wheat, soya bean, peanuts, cotton. So you can see here about 40 ozone ppb. If you have about 40 ppb or less than 40 ppb, to be more precise 30 ppb, then there is no effect. So you have relative yield is about 100%. But if the ozone concentration increases more than 30, then you can see the decrease in the yield. So up to 30 ppb, ozone I'm talking about the tropospheric ozone. I'm not discussing much here, but tropospheric ozone, if you have more than 30 ppb, then you have a very, very different effect, and then the yield of the crops will decrease. Another very important thing that we have seen, must have seen, like, you know, smog, it also very important. Ozone is very important ingredient in that. So it, photochemical reactions can happen in this one, and then like, you know, you have a precursor gases that are emitted from different, like, industries, car, and then forest fires. So you have carbon monoxide, NO, NO2, and hydrocarbons, volatile organic compounds. So these are basically the precursors for this one, and then through the photosynthesis, this, they can lead to the formation of ozone. So because already we know that tropospheric ozone is not good for us, and this, it can lead to the decrease in the crop yield, and even if you have high ozone, you can have a skin problem also, even in the human also. I would not go in much details because this is a very critical slides here, but what you can see here, that you have, you have emissions of for example methane, CO, non-methane hydrocarbons, and NO. These are different routes for this one, then different chemical products processes will be there, but there will be some kind of, you know, and then ozone can also come from the stratosphere. We call it stratosphere troposphere exchange. So some part of ozone can come from there as well, but it usually occurs in the spring season. And this ozone can be deposited on the plants, like they're under their leaves and then other processes. And then they can then start their secondary effect. In the photochemistry, so you can, in this slide, very clearly you can see the seasonal variation in ozone concentration. So about 8 o'clock in the morning, the ozone concentration starts increasing. And about it remains there up to about, like, you know, 18 hours or so. I mean, like about 6 p.m. or 5 p.m. So this is basically because this tropospheric ozone formation needs ingredients from the precursors as well as the photolysis has to be there. Otherwise, the reaction will not happen. So this is needed. So you can see very clearly that during the daytime, when you have sunlight, this ozone production can be there. And this is the typical graph, diurnal variability for carbon monoxide and NOx. You can see the variations here. These are also related with the emission patterns, are related with the different, like, you know, kind of, you know, when we go outside from the vehicles and other. So I stop here, and I thank you very much for your listening. And not but the least, I'd like to thank the Arvind Ranade sir, Dr. Nishi Srivastav for arranging logistical arrangement, and then Ashish Raudre for this discussion and this. And if you have any questions and comments, you can please write to me through email, or you can just use my phone for any discussion. So I stop here, and if you have any questions or comments, I would be happy to, I will try to answer them. Okay?
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Well, the presentation was really wonderful.
So you can open your video.
I will just. So now I stop sharing, and then
there are a few questions. I'm reading just first one for you. The first question is from Mr. Bhavesh Modi. The question is, how is ozone measured in the atmosphere?
Okay, so as I said, that there are two type of measurement for ozone. One, if we talk about the tropospheric ozone is usually measured and reported in terms of ppb. Okay, so there are different, we have a ozone spectrometer, there are different instruments basically, and then they measure the particular UV radiation is thrown in the gas chamber, and then based on the UV radiation, what is happening there, the radiation, decrease in the radiation will be measured, and then based on their attenuation coefficient or the absorption, we will be calculating this one ozone concentration. So this is usually done for the tropospheric ozone. And then the similar process is there for the stratospheric ozone. It is usually measured, as I said, that it is in the Dobson unit. So please don't confuse. In the tropospheric ozone be present in the terms of ppb, and in the stratospheric ozone, we usually present in the Dobson unit. So Dobson unit is basically a columnar concentration. Okay.
Okay, sir. The second question is also from Mr. Bhavesh. He wants to ask that how is ozone level expected to change in the coming decades?
Yeah, that's really very wonderful question, actually. And then I'm very happy to listen this question, to hear this question. Because, see, this is very important. Let me give just a little bit few basics on this one. So, as I said in the lecture, that our environment is very unique in the sense that we have so fixed composition of different species that if you alter one, the other is going to be disturbed. Okay, so as now we know that, for example, nobody was not knowing about the ozone hole formation or destruction of ozone until we discovered this chlorofluorohydrocarbons. We started using chlorofluorohydrocarbons without knowing their side effects. Okay, so then again this halons came, and then the different ozone depleting substances are coming in the atmosphere. So one of the very important things is there that researchers must be done to understand that what are the different compounds that can lead to the destruction of ozone. Actually, we know little bit of that one. For example, as I said, the CFCs and halons, but we really don't know. For example, suppose we are using the refrigerants, foams we are using, we were using unknowingly. But little bit are, I think, some of the research to be focusing on this one to discover some more ozone depleting substances. I think I the answer is clear.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So okay, the next question is from Vagish Mishra. He wants to ask that how much variation in ozone concentration in troposphere and stratosphere is expected due to changes in the radiation with the maxima and minima of solar cycle. Do you want me to repeat the question, sir?
I think it's long question, so I couldn't follow. And there is some disconnectivity, actually. I don't know whether my lecture was smooth or not, but there is so you can just repeat the question, please.
Yes. The question is, how much variation in ozone concentration in troposphere and stratosphere is expected due to changes in the radiation with the maxima and minima of solar cycle?
Okay. So that's again a very good question. So there are two parts of this answer to answer this one. I talk about the stratospheric ozone, stratospheric ozone is controlled by the incoming solar radiation and particularly the UV radiations, okay? Especially the radiations that leads to the dissociation of oxygen molecule and then subsequently into the formation of ozone. So there is not, I think there is no direct calculation that how much percentage wise will be there, but it will certainly, for example, if there is an increase in the photon which are having radiations of say 100 to 210 nanometer, they will lead to destruction of more ozone molecule. So when more oxygen molecule. So when the more oxygen molecule are destructed, basically you have a more oxygen, nascent oxygen, and then they can recombine and then they can form the oxygen. Now, another question is, the other half of this question is there, that suppose we have a radiation, that radiation increase is there in the UV, specifically say around 240 to 320 nanometer, then what will be happening here? Here the ozone itself will be depleted because the ozone destruction will be happening in this light. So it's important to know that how much fraction of the, what fraction of basically the UV radiation is there due to changes in the solar maxima and minima. So I really cannot answer exactly on this one, but this is one thing. And then if you talk about the tropospheric ozone is not dependent on the solar maxima and minima. It is mostly dependent on the ingredients that are present in the troposphere, its precursors, like basically non-methane hydrocarbons, NOx, VOCs, and then basically the temperature. The temperature here itself, it initiates actually the formation of this one. So there are two different aspects of that. But this was really a very wonderful question.
Thank you, sir. Supan Aituji wants to ask that do changes in the sun atmosphere or volcanic eruptions have any effect on ozone layer?
Yeah, so I think I partly answered in the last part of this question has been addressed in the last question. So if there is a, basically she is also talking about that how the solar, if the, there is a change in the solar radiation, how the formation or destruction of ozone can be there. So this I addressed already, and the stratosphere and troposphere separately. Volcanoes as such, they don't have much effect because volcanoes, what is there? When there is a volcanoes basically they produce lots of ashes and then sulfur dioxide gas in the atmosphere. So until there are some effects, if this sulfur dioxide, for example, there is a small volcano. So if there is a small volcano, you don't expect much changes in the ozone in the stratosphere because ozone, this SO2 may not be reaching to the stratosphere. But if we have a big old volcano like Pinatubo, volcanic eruptions, which can take this SO2 in the higher in the atmosphere, say in the stratosphere, this SO2 can react with the ozone actually, and this can then form this sulfur dioxide, H2SO4, sulfuric acid in the atmosphere there. So there are some studies that suggest that if you have a sufficient SO2 in the upper troposphere, and not upper troposphere, especially in the stratosphere, then this SO2 can be oxidized to sulfuric acid. So that is there, but there is no quantification. Small volcanoes will not have any on ozone actually.
Okay, so next question is from Mr. Himanshu Shekhar. He wants to know about the current trends of stratospheric ozone concentration over Indo-Gangetic plains. Current trends of stratospheric ozone concentration over Indo-Gangetic plains.
Okay, so as I said that stratospheric ozone concentration, columnar concentration in the Indo-Gangetic plain, there are not much studies in this one actually. To be honest, I have not seen much studies in the stratospheric ozone, that whether how much decrease is there. But I can get back to him with some reference, because I really don't have any proper reference at this moment. But I can look at some literature, probably some paper may be there actually. But stratospheric ozone, I have not seen in the Indo-Gangetic plain. There are studies on the tropospheric ozone, but stratospheric ozone, we have very clearly seen that tropospheric ozone concentration is increasing, and I don't expect that there should be any decrease in the stratospheric ozone, because this ozone depletion and other things happens mostly in the colder region. In the Indo-Gangetic plain, I doubt actually, but I am not very sure about this answer.
सर बैद्यनाथ मिश्रा जी वांट्स टू आस्क दैट घर में उपयोग किए जाने वाले इलेक्ट्रॉनिक डिवाइसेस से भी क्या ओजोन परत पे प्रभाव पड़ता है?
घर में यूज किए जाने वाले इलेक्ट्रॉनिक डिवाइसेस नहीं, अब इलेक्ट्रॉनिक डिवाइसेस के बहुत ब्रॉड कैटेगरी हो गया. आई डोंट नो एक्चुअली व्हिच इलेक्ट्रॉनिक डिवाइस इज एक्चुअली मीन टेलिंग. सो फॉर एग्जांपल, वन ऑफ द वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग वाज रेफ्रिजरेटर एंड देन दिस एयर कंडीशनर्स दैट वी यूज्ड टू यूज. ओके, now in this one, we used to use this CFCs as a coolant. Okay, so when this CFCs were emitted in the atmosphere, they go they can reach the stratosphere and then they destroy this ozone. But other appliances, until and unless they produce an ozone depleting substances, they would not have any impact of this one. But if they are producing an ozone depleting substances, then certainly they will be there. So it depends on which kind of electronics he is referring to. I don't know. And then whether it is whether that device is emitting any ozone depleting substance or not. So I can't answer very clearly.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, for your time. In the end, if you want to conclude anything.
Yeah, so I just want to say that, okay, on this ozone day, this is very important theme that is coming actually, ozone. We already have discussed lots of things that is coming. And then one more important that tropospheric ozone that is there actually, we have seen the increasing trend in the tropospheric ozone over almost like, especially in the northern part, we have seen a huge increase in ozone, tropospheric ozone concentration. And since the ozone concentration, tropospheric ozone concentration has a direct linkage to the crop productivity and then plant growth and photosynthesis, I think there should be some regulations to reduce this tropospheric ozone concentration. And I think another important, as an environmental chemist, we all have a responsibility, because the environment that we are living, it is very beautiful. It's providing all the ingredients that we need, whether it be the air, and then oxygen, then water, then all the fresh. We need to plant many trees as much as we can actually. But of course, there are different aspects that secondary or soil are so far from. So that is another research area that we can discuss sometimes later, not now. And but this is it is our prime duty that we should save our environment. We should take care of our environment, whatever small effort we can do. I'm not saying that we should be stop using everything and then to control that one, that cannot be done. But what is there that we have to do as a responsible citizen, we have to do it very importantly, that how we can save our environment, how can make our environment more cleaner actually, and then greener. So that's all that I can want to say to everybody. I mean, take some steps, whatever small you can do for to save our environment, to help our environment in a better safe actually. So that's what actually. So the message that is there.
Thank you so much, sir. Now it's time for winding the session. I would like to invite Ki Sachin Narvadia, sir, to please see forward for the vote of thanks.
Okay, Sachin, so sir. I hope that I did not exceed much time actually. I was in time, so I took around 45 to 50 minutes, right? So,
no, sir, not at all. We are within the time.
Okay.
Sachin, sir.
Okay, sir.
Hello.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. So, yes, please.
Yes, sir. The lecture was very awesome, and we got lots of fresh knowledge about ozone and new updates what is going on. And ozone, as we all know, that it stops the ultraviolet rays from sun and we saves the life on the earth. So I'm thankful to you, sir, for your valuable time and energy for this lecture. And I definitely sure that our VIPnet members will able to take advantage of this lecture. And I also thankful for all VIPnet club members for their association in this lecture. And also this lecture is available for YouTube for post viewers. I am thankful to Arvind sir and Dr. Nakul Parashar for their kind guidance to organize this Tuesday lecture series, and my colleagues Vipin and Nidhi and Pavan for their association and their work for organizing this lecture. Thank you, sir. Thank you to all.
Thank you, Sachin. Thank you. It was a pleasure to be there, and I like to interact with the our teachers, especially who, because they are very they can be very good resource for us actually. They can teach our students, especially those young children. That is very important, because the message has to go. We have to start from our young children. We have to leave something for our coming generation. That is more important. So we have enough resources, but that doesn't mean that we should pollute or we should misuse or do whatever kind of things we are there. We have to keep a kind of, make the environment that our future generation can avail that. So that is really very important. And I'm very thankful to DST and Vigyan Prasar for organizing such events. These events are very important despite this lockdown and everything. You guys are doing very wonderful job. So I must thank all of you, Randa Day sir, Nidhi ma'am, and then Rawat ji and Sachin aapko bhi. So sabhi logon ko bahut sari shubhkamnaye, aur main aapko aap logon ke liye bahut acche shubhkamnaon ke sath ye chahunga ki aur aap log series ko organize kare logon ko.
Yes sir, share.
Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Dhanyavaad.
Thank you. Thank you.